Lecture 9 of the subject English Literature is devoted to the theme English Literature of the Restoration Period. Objectives. This lecture will make the students know about historical overview of Restoration Age, its socio-political happenings and its impact on the literary production of the age. Literary features of the age, prose, poetry and drama of the period, the major writers with their major works of literature. During this lecture, we are going to discuss the following questions: the historical background of the period, English literature of the Restoration period, Francis Bacon, John Bunyan, John Dryden, John Milton, and his great poem Paradise Lost. The 17th century was marked by the important events in English history. The most important in the 17th century bourgeoisie revolution. The contradiction between feudal and bourgeoisie sharpened and reached their climax. The bourgeoisie once had supported the queen turned against absolute monarchy, which was no longer progressive and hindered the further development of capitalism in England. The struggle between two sides continued during the reign of Charles I. The House of Commons worked out the Petition of Rights aimed at limiting the king's power, and the king had to sign it. Then Charles I dissolved the parliament and ruled for 11 years till 1640. Those who supported the king were called royalists. Those who supported the commons were called the Puritans. In 1642, the king declared war on parliament, and the civil war began between the royalists and the parliamentarians and lasted till 1649. The parliamentary army, headed by Oliver Cromwell, consisted of the representatives of bourgeoisie, gentry, artisans, and other working people. Oliver Cromwell, the leader of independence, in long parliament demanded the monarchy. The royalists were defeated because the masses took the side of parliament, and thus the bourgeoisie revolution triumphed. Charles I was beheaded in 1649. The House of Lords were abolished. The Republic was proclaimed. Later, frightened by revolutionary spirit of masses, Cromwell imposed the military dictatorship in 1653. As neither the common people nor the upper classes were satisfied with the results of the Puritan revolution, the monarchy was restored after Cromwell's death. Charles II acceded the throne in 1660. The years between 1660 and 1668 are called the Restoration. Restoration period was marked by the names of such writers as Francis Bacon, John Bunyan, and John Dryden. The first half of the 17th century as a whole, compared with the Elizabethan age, was a period of relaxing vigor. The Renaissance enthusiasm had spent itself, and in place of the danger and glory which had long united the nation, there followed increasing dissension in religion and politics, and uncertainty as to the future of the England and as to the whole purpose of life. Nevertheless, the spirit includes in prose one writer greater than any prose writer of the previous century, namely Francis Bacon, and further the book which unquestionably occupies the highest place in English literature. That is the King James version of the Bible, and in poetry it includes one of the very greatest figures, John Milton, together with a varied and highly interesting assemblage of lesser lyrists. Francis Bacon, intellectually one of the most eminent Englishmen of all times and chief formulator of the methods of modern science, was born in 1561, the son of Sir Nicholas Bacon, Lord Keeper of the Great Seal under Queen Elizabeth, and one of the most trusted early advisers. At the age of 12, he was sent to Cambridge, where his chief impression was of disgust at the unfruitful scholastic application of Aristotle's ideas still supreme in spite of a century of Renaissance enlightenment. A very much more satisfactory 3 years' residence in France in the household of the English ambassador was terminated in 1579 by the death of Sir Nicholas. Bacon was now ready to enter the great career for which his talents fitted him. But his uncle by marriage, Lord Burghley, through all-powerful with the Queen, systematically thwarted his progress from jealous consciousness of his superiority to his own son. Bacon therefore studied law and was soon chosen a member of Parliament, where he quickly became a leader. He continued, however, throughout his life to devote much of his time to study and scholarly scientific writing. Only one of his books still commonly read is the series of essays, which consists of brief and comparatively informal jottings on various subjects. In their earliest form in 1597, the essays were 10 in number, but by additions from time to time they had increased at last 1625 to 58. They deal with a great variety of topics, whatever Bacon happened to be interested in, from friendship to the arrangement of a house and their condensation. They are more like bare synopses than complete discussions. But their comprehensiveness of view, sureness of ideas and phrasing, suggestiveness and apt illustrations reveal the pregnancy and practical force of Bacon's thoughts. The whole general tone of the essays also shows the man, keen and worldly, not at all poet or idealist. John Bennion was born in 1628 at the village of Elstow, just outside of Bedford in central England. After very slight schooling and some practice at his father's trade of tinker, he was in 1644 drafted for 2 years and a half into garrison service in the Parliamentary Army. Released from this occupation, he married a poor but excellent wife and worked at his trade, but the important experiences of his life were the religious ones. Endowed by nature with a great moral sensitiveness, he was nevertheless a person of violent impulses. John Bennion has told the whole story in his spiritual autobiography, Grace Abounding to the Chief of Sinners, which is one of the notable religious books of the world. A reader of it must be filled about equally with admiration for the force of will and perseverance that enabled Bennion at last to win his battle. A man of so energetic spirit could not long remain inactive, and within 2 years he was preaching in the surrounding villages. A dispute with the Franks had already led to the beginning of his controversial writing, when in 1660 the Restoration rendered preaching by persons outside the communion of the Church of England illegal, and he was arrested and imprisoned in Bedford Jail. During this time, he wrote and published several of the most important of his 60 books and pamphlets. In 1672, the authorities abandoned the ineffective requirement of conformity and he was released and became pastor of his church. 3 years later, he was again imprisoned for 6 months, and it was at that time that he composed the first part of the Pilgrim's Progress, which was published in 1678. Pilgrim's Progress is perfectly intelligible to any child, and further, it's highly dramatic and picturesque. Several of Bennion's books are strong, but none of the others is to be named together with The Pilgrim's Progress. This has been translated into nearly or quite 100 languages and dialects, a record never approached by any other book of English authorship. John Dryden, the son of the family of Northamptonshire County, was born in 1631. From Westminster School and Cambridge, he went at about the age of 26 and possessed by inheritance of a minimum living income to London, where he perhaps hoped to get political preferment through his relatives in the Puritan Party. His serious entrance into literature was made comparatively late in 1659. When the next year Charles II was restored, Dryden shifted to the royalist side and wrote some poems in honor of the king. Dryden's character should be judged from his incidents and similar ones in his later life to hastily, nor without regard to the spirit of the times. Dryden's marriage with the daughter of an earl, 2 or 3 years after the Restoration, secured his social position, and as for more than 15 years thereafter, his life was outwardly successful. He first turned to the drama. In spite of the prohibitory Puritan law, Sir William Davenant had begun cautiously a few years before the Restoration to produce operas and other works of dramatic nature, and the returning court had brought from Paris a passion of the stage, which therefore offered the best and indeed the only field of remunerative literature effort. Accordingly, also, Dryden himself frankly admitted that his talents were not especially adapted to writing plays. He proceeded to do so energetically and continued nearly down to the end of his life, 35 years later. The next year, he became engaged in political controversy, which resulted in the production of his most famous work. In his comedies and his comic portions of the others, he, like other English dramatists, uses prose for its suggestion of everyday reality. In place of serious tone, he often turns to blank verse, and this is the meter of all for love. Dryden's general quality and a large part of his achievement are happily summarized in Lowell's epigram that he was the greatest poet ever could be made wholly out of prose. He can never again be a favorite with the general reading public, but he will always remain one of the contrastless figures in the history of English literature. He wrote poetic plays, including the famous one about Antony and Cleopatra, All for Love, and many lyrics, also literary criticism and political satires, which were the outcome of the Puritan royalist controversies. He was often called the father of prose. John Milton, the greatest of all publicists of the period of the Puritan Revolution. His pamphlets give political foundation to the struggle. He was born in London in 1608 in the family of prosperous Scrivener. At first, he attended St. Paul's School. His progress was very rapid, and at the age of 16, he entered the University of Cambridge. Later, he retired and gave himself to study of poetry. Many of his poems were written there. These poems comprise the first period of his creative work. In 1637, he left England for the European Tour. He visited France and Italy. Later, he will mention this meeting in his book Paradise Lost. In 1639, he returned to England, and the years between 1640-1660 were the second period of his literary work, during which he wrote mainly revolutionary pamphlets. Most of them were written in Latin because Milton wanted Europe to understand that the Puritan Revolution in England wasn't rebellion, but it was the only force which could give the people rights and freedom. Milton had very weak eyes, and in 1652 he lost his eyesight completely. With the restoration of the monarchy, Milton was discharged from the office and his pamphlets were burned. He moved to a small house near London and devoted himself to the writing of poetry. These years of his retirement were the third period of his work. During this period, he created the most famous book, his great epic Paradise Lost, and his second epic Paradise Regained in 1671. The plot of many of his works were taken from the Bible. One of the most popular of his epics was Paradise Lost. It was very unusual not from the viewpoint of the plot, but from the viewpoint of the main hero because it was Satan. The other heroes are God, angels, and three guardian angels, Raphael, Gabriel, and Michael, Adam and Eve. Satan symbolized revolutionary spirit. He revolts against God and was driven out of heaven into the fire of hell. He hates God who rules autocratically. Milton meant the king. The second line of the plot deals with Adam and Eve. They were allowed to live in paradise in the Garden of Eden as so long as they don't eat the apples from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Milton symbolizes with these characters and shows his deep belief and faith in man. Adam and Eve were like humanists of Renaissance. Milton remained faithful to his formal ideas. He died in 1674 and was buried in London. His works form a sort of a bridge between the poetry of Renaissance period and the poetry of his classics. Milton's work are characterized by their duality, which means that two independent views go together. He closes his plot from the Bible. But under his treatment, they became rather revolutionary. He won the greatest popularity not only in European countries, but in Russia too. This is the end of our lecture. Conclusion. The English Civil War from 1642-1651 was a civil war between the people of England that wanted to change their government from a more traditional form of government to a more republican government that involved the people. Between 1642 and 1660, Cromwell outlawed theatre because of its connections with the monarchy and, according to his Puritan values, were immoral. Here, in this very slide, given the questions for self-checking. Here, given the glossary concerning our lecture. Here, given the literature for further reading.